Well, hello everyone, and thank you so much for being here with us. I know Mom would have been very pleased to see everybody here. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Don Jr. I am the eldest son of Don and Irene Fritz, and my siblings, Diane, Sue, Bob, Linda, and Judy, all asked that I would eulogize our mother. And I hope I don't disappoint, but if you know, the word eulogy comes from a Greek word that means praise. And trust me when I say all six of us children have plenty of praise that we could give our mother. But to me, perhaps the best is the fact that she was the saintliest woman we ever knew. And we were blessed to have the best example of God's love as we were growing up, as we could have. And so let me tell you a little bit about Irene Margaret Fritz. She was the only daughter of Ernest and Alvira Stalins. In her youth, she was very athletic herself, for your grandchildren, competing in archery and playing in field hockey, and I'm sure others. When she was a young woman, she met and married her first love, Dan Fritz. And yes, I got the name correct. For those of you who don't know the story, Dan and Irene were married, and they had her oldest sister, Diane. And when Diane was just a toddler, sadly, Dan passed away. And then about a year and a half later, Irene married her second love, Don Fritz, Dan's brother. Now, Don and Irene went on to have the rest of us children, and they enjoyed a long marriage of 54 years. Now, you might think that that marriage scenario is a little unique, let's say, right? But if you lived in Old Testament times, you would recognize it. It's known as the Levirate marriage law. And in Deuteronomy 25, it describes it like this. If brothers dwell together and one of them dies and has no son, the wife of the dead shall not be married outside the family to a stranger. Her husband's brother shall go into her and take her as his wife, and perform the duty of a husband's brother to her. And the first son whom she bears shall succeed the name of his brother who is dead. Now, I don't know that Dad had that in mind when he proposed to Mom, but I do know that Dad loved Mom very much, right? And I also know that that was God's divine plan for Mom, to provide her with that perfect second marriage that's pleasing to God. So now Mom's up in heaven with God, right? And she's also there with Dan and Don. And I can only imagine the conversation between those brothers when they see their sweet Irene come walking into heaven, right? Hey, Dan, look, there's my wife, Irene. excuse me, Don, she was my wife too? Yeah, but she was my wife last. So she was mine first. Well, you know, I had her longer. Exactly, Don. It's my turn. I've got lost time to make up for, right? Interesting scenario. So what does the Bible say about marriage in heaven? In Matthew 22, it tells us when the Sadducees approached Jesus, quizzing him like they typically did, trying to trip him up in the law. And they asked him about the Levirate marriage and what happens in heaven. And Jesus responded this way in Matthew 22, I forget the verse, but it says, but Jesus answered them, you are wrong because you know neither the scriptures nor the power of God. For in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven. So as I read that text, I'm not so concerned now about the three of them up in heaven trying to iron out the issue of the marriage situation, because they're in the presence of God, perfect love, perfect holiness. And like the angels, the way I'm thinking, they're up there praising and worshiping God right now as we sit here praising Mom. So, but I can tell you that Irene was a very good wife to both her husbands. And in Proverbs 31, it says, a good wife who can find. She is far more precious than jewels. And if you read the rest of that chapter, which I have many times, and every time I did, it describes a good or a godly wife, and it always reminded me of Mom. It just fit her to a T, and I wish I could go through all of it. But so let me share a little bit about her marriage. I can't speak to her marriage with Dan, but I can with Don. So I'll share a little bit of how Mom loved Dad and how she served by his side. So when we lived in Sterling Heights, they bought partial interest in a company that made contact lens cases, and they operated that out of our basement. And while Mom was managing her household and raising her children, she was also the one doing most of the work in that business. When they moved up to Lewiston and bought Villager Restaurant, which many of you have been to, she worked along with Dad and managed that business side by side for the many years that they owned it. Then they sold the restaurant and Dad got his real estate license. Well, thinking that he was going to be, you know, taxed too much on his income, he decided to ask Mom to get her license, you know, for tax reasons. And well, Mom did, and you know, truly, I think Mom ended up selling more homes than he did. But the best example I can give of how Mom displayed selfless love for Dad is in the way that she cared for him in his final years. And it was many years that Dad wasn't well and needed a lot of care. And it was difficult for Mom, but she cared for him in such a loving manner. I mean, you guys all know that. So moving on in Proverbs 31, it describes a good wife also as one whose children rise up and call her blessed. And I can guarantee you that we all are rising up today and thinking of our blessed mother, how we've been blessed with her as well. So what I did was I asked my siblings to each share one example of how Mom displayed selfless love to them or exhibited God's love as an example for us, right? And so I'll read those to you, and I'm going to read them in order of birth. Diane would like to say, from day one, my mom has been the one I could count on in good times and bad, the first one I'd call on to share my news. When she sensed I was down, she asked me to share my burden. Don't worry, Mom said. I have big shoulders. She has always been my biggest advocate, my best friend, my rock, and my most genuine, loving, and the most generous loving woman I've ever known. And to me, that reminds me of Jesus said, come to me, you who are labor and have heavy burden, I will give you rest, right? I mean, that's just one example of how Mom was like Christ to us. I'll introduce Sue's story by reading the beginning lines of a paper that her daughter Allison wrote as a child titled The Gift, and it's actually out in the foyer. My grandma and grandpa are always there for me. They are always thinking of me. When I was a baby, I was very ill. Both my grandma and grandpa came down to watch me. My dad had to go with Mom to another hospital, and I'll add that was an out-of-state hospital, because she was very sick. They watched me until my mom was better. And the way Sue described it to me, what impressed her the most was the way that Mom had asked Sue, how do you want me to care for Allison? And Sue said, you know, I trust you. I mean, after all, you've had six children of your own, right? But Mom was insistent on, no, I want to know how you want me to care, how you're going to care for her. And I think Mom knew, I mean, she obviously knew the importance of the mother-child bond in those early days. And I think Mom was trying to make sure that when the care was transitioned back to Sue, that it was a seamless transition for Allison. I mean, that's just how thoughtful and kind she was. So to Sue, that was an example that she's going to carry on and emulate with her grandchildren. Bob and mine's story is the same one. We were camping at a neighbor's cabin, Eschner's, and they had two cabins actually on a lake. One was a small older cabin down by the lake and a newer one up on the hill that they were building. Each had a separate dock. And Bob and I decided to go bass fishing one night, late at night, just before sundown and afterwards. And while we were on the lake, a thunderstorm comes rolling in. We, on our way back in, get caught in a downpour, so we row into the cabin closest to the lake, not the dock we left from. And that's where we slept the night. We didn't go up the hill to tell our mother we were safe. So she went down the hill to the dock we left from. Our boat wasn't there. She hollered to us, didn't hear us respond. She got in that boat, rowed around the lake looking for us, in her robe, in the dark, in a thunderstorm. Selfless love. Linda recalls how Mom was in being an athlete herself, enjoyed going to watch Jacob and Antoine's games. And Mom was a real trooper, sticking out the whole game, even though it was cold and wet, until the end of the game, sitting there in the bleachers. And she recalls one time where they were watching a game, and it was halftime, and it was raining and cold, and Mom was dressed warm with a heavy poncho and boots, but still, Linda could see that she was probably a little uncomfortable, and asked if she wanted to spend second half in the car. And Mom says, well, is the game over? Linda said, no. Mom said, well, then no, thank you. I'm here to the end of the game, right? Mom absolutely loves seeing her grandchildren play in their sports, and I know every time I talked with her and she'd been to a game, she would tell me all about it. So she was very proud of all of you grandchildren, and that was one of the highlights of her life. So Judy, last but not least, she'll never forget the time that when Dalton was born, he was critically ill. And Mom came down to be by her side and see that Dalton had made it through his surgery okay. And when Dalton was healing in Children's Hospital, Mom went back to be with Ashley and their dog Rebel, and she dedicated her time to taking care of them, making sure they were loved, cared for, entertained, and without worry. And like I said before, Judy said, Mom was always, always there when we needed her. And so that's just a little bit about our mother. And I could spend so much time telling you more. The two things that, the two ways that I would describe her is one, you know, she was strong in her faith, and she lived that out for all of us to see, right? And Mom was selfless in her love, and she lavished it on her husband, on his children, her great-grandchildren, and even a great-grandchild. And so, yes, we have plenty to praise our mother for, and we do rise up and call her blessed, right? Yes. So, Mom, we love you. Oh, we certainly miss you, but we know that you're up in heaven with God, and that brings us comfort and joy. So, thank you all.
Ask you to please stand now for the opening song, Be Not Afraid. You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander
pray in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, we gather this morning to pray for our sister Irene. We ask God to grant her everlasting life. We pray that God would give us his comfort and strength. As we gather for this celebration of Irene's life, as we gather for the Eucharist, let us first call to mind our sins and ask God's forgiveness. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy. You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy. You intercede for us at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. Holy Lord, Almighty and Eternal God, hear our prayers for your servant Irene, whom you have summoned out of this world. Forgive her sins and failings, and grant her a place of refreshment, light, and peace. Let her pass unharmed through the gates of death to dwell with the blessed in light, as you promised to Abraham and his children forever. Accept Irene into your safe keeping, and on that great day of judgment, raise her up with all the saints to inherit your eternal kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for the scripture readings.
There shall be no more death. A reading from the book of Revelation. I, John, saw a new heaven and a new earth. The former heaven and the former earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I also saw the holy city, a new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, God's dwelling is with the human race. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will always be with them as their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there shall be no more death or mourning, wailing or pain, for the old order has passed away." The one who sat on the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give a gift from the spring of life-giving water. The victor will inherit these gifts, and I shall be his God, and he will be my son." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. He's my shepherd, so nothing shall I want. I rest in the meadows of faithfulness and love. I walk by the quiet waters of peace. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, death into life. Though I should wander the valley of death, I fear no evil, for you are at my side. your rod and your staff, my comfort and my home. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. Surely your kindness and mercy follow me all the days of my life. I will dwell in the house of my God forevermore. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, death into
thus we shall always be with the Lord. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. We do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, about those who have fallen asleep, so that you may not grieve like the rest, who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose, so too will God, through Jesus, bring with him those who have fallen asleep. Indeed, we tell you this, on the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will surely not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself, with a word of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, will come down from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, we are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, console one another with these words, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the gospel.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. I am the resurrection and the life. They who believe in me will have eternal life. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. At that time, Jesus answered, I give praise to you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for although you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned, you have revealed them to the childlike. Yes, Father, such has been your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wishes to reveal him. Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart, and you will find rest for yourselves. For my yoke is easy and my burden light. My brothers and sisters, the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. I'm Father Stan Allman, pastor of St. Mary of the Hills, and on behalf of St. Mary's, I'd like to extend our condolences to Irene's family, especially to her children, Diane, Sue, Don, Bob, Linda, Judy, her 20 grandchildren, her 14 great-grandchildren, and her one great-great-grandchild. We gather with you this morning to pray that God would grant Irene everlasting life. We come together to pray that God would give us his comfort and his strength. If a stranger should walk in on our funeral mass this morning, they might be a bit puzzled. In the face of death, they would hear us talking about life. In the face of our sorrow and sadness, they would hear hymns of joy. In the face of our loss, they would hear prayers of gratitude. And in the face of human weakness, they would hear talk about forgiveness. And they might scratch their heads and say, "How come? By what right do we say such seemingly contradictory things? Forgiveness in the face of weakness, gratitude in the face of loss, joy in the face of sorrow, life in the face of death. How come? By what right?" And our only response to them, our only adequate response, would be one word: Jesus. Jesus. Our faith in him, our hope in him, our trust in the fantastic promises that he makes to his followers allows us to say and do what it is that we say and do this morning. For this Jesus tells us that nothing can separate us from God's love. Jesus assures us that we are not destined to die, but rather to live. Jesus offers his own life, sheds his own blood, that we might be reconciled to God and reconciled with each other. Jesus promises everlasting life. We've placed Irene's ashes in front of the Paschal candle, the candle that we bless at Easter time when we celebrate Jesus' resurrection. It is also the candle that accompanies those who come for the sacrament of baptism. And so today we recall Irene's baptism, because it was in that sacrament that she was joined to this Jesus. It was in that sacrament that those promises of everlasting life were made to her for the first time. In the waters of baptism, she was consecrated as a daughter of God. She became a member of God's family, the church. She was inserted into that body of believing people we call the communion of saints. And because of that union and that membership, the prayer that we're praying this morning is not just our prayer, the prayer of us that are gathered here, but rather it's the prayer of the whole church. It's the prayer of all of those who stand with us in faith before God to give God praise and thanks. Praise and thanks for our gift of life. Praise and thanks for our salvation in Jesus. Praise and thanks for God's continued presence and love. We trust that those promises of everlasting life that were made to Irene long ago at her baptism are indeed fulfilled today. While we're here to pray for Irene, in a real sense, we're also here to pray for each other. Death, in its cruel way, seems to say that life has no value, no meaning. After all, when someone we love dies, all that seems to remain is a dark, empty void. But we say no. We say life is the final word. Jesus has won a victory. We are heirs with him to that victory. And so this morning we pray especially for those who will miss Irene most. We want to assure them that God has not abandoned them, nor is he punishing them, but rather, like that good shepherd, walks with them through their dark valley. He will bring light into that darkness. He will help them carry the burden of their loss. He will fulfill for them his promises, and certainly his promise of everlasting life. He will restore joy to their hearts. Those of us who've taken time this morning to be with the family in their moments of sorrow and sadness are the very sign of God's love and presence. For St. John reminds us that where love abides, God abides. And when we take time to offer sympathy or condolences, we're offering love. And through that expression of love, we make God real and present to each other. Finally, we come together this morning perhaps to look at our own lives in terms of this reality called death. Our faith testifies that life is a gift, a good gift, a gift that God gives us freely to be lived in this world for shorter, or as with Irene, for a longer period of time, but a gift that in death doesn't end. We believe that in death, the Lord takes that gift of life, removes all the imperfections from it, and then restores it back to us, back to be lived in a fullness and a completion that we can't even imagine. We trust Irene lives that newness and fullness of life, that everything that was good and true and beautiful in her life, God has taken, perfected, and now allows her to live for an eternity. The question we might ask ourselves is, what are we going to stand with before the Lord? What is it of our lives that he's going to be able to take and perfect and return to us to live forever? What values, what attitudes, what things do we live for and strive for that are worthy of living for an eternity? These past few days, we've been reflecting on Irene's 91 years of life. Some of those moments were captured in the pictures that you were looking at in the vestibule. We capture a lot of her life in the stories that we tell. For God has blessed us with a particular gift that allows a person who physically is no longer there to be with us, that gift of memory. And I certainly want to thank Don for sharing so much about his mom with us, this wonderful lady, this great person who mirrored Jesus to us, the image of one who served selflessly others. And so I certainly would recommend that we use this gift, that we continue to share stories, that we look at this legacy that Irene left us of her 91 years. But no matter how many things we can recall, there is one who knows every moment of her life. The good and the bad, the hopes and the dreams, the successes and the failures. And that one is a loving and gracious God. A loving and gracious God who takes it all, perfects the best, and now returns it back to her to live forever. What are we going to stand with before that God? What is it of our lives that he's going to take and perfect and return to us to live for an eternity? Our prayer this morning is actually threefold. We've come together to pray that God would fulfill those promises of baptism made to Irene long ago. We've come together to share with each other the hope that we have because of our faith in Jesus. And finally, we come to look at our own lives in terms of this reality called death. In the gospel reading, Jesus says to his disciples, "Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart, and you will find rest for yourselves. That yoke of Jesus means that he accompanies us. He helps us to carry our burdens. He gives us the strength. He gives us the direction. He gives us the inspiration to live lives that are truly full, lives of peace and joy, of kindness and compassion, of forgiveness and of love. Jesus teaches us what's important in our lives. People judge success in various ways. Some judge it by the wealth that people have. Others judge it by the power they wield or the popularity that they have. But the real measure of success in life is love. How much did we love? How much were we loved? And certainly by that measure, Irene's life was a success. And so we thank God. We thank God for those 91 years of her life. We thank God for how her love touched us, or perhaps transformed us. We thank God for the opportunity to show gratitude for her life. And we pray that one day we will rejoin her with Dan and Don and all those who've gone before us to stand before God to give God praise and thanks. Praise and thanks for our gift of life. Praise and thanks for our salvation in Jesus. Praise and thanks for God's continued presence and love. Help us, Lord, that this moment of sorrow and sadness might be transformed into that peace and joy that you promise each of us. Please rise as we present our petitions to our loving and gracious God.
Bishops and priests of the church and all who preach the gospel may be given the strength to express in action the word they proclaim. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those in public office may promote justice and peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who bear the cross of pain in mind and body may never feel forsaken by God, especially Liam O'Donovan, Floyd Gritzelius, and Jennifer Fritz. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may deliver the soul of his servant, Irene Fritz, from punishment and from powers of darkness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God, in his mercy, may blot out all of her offenses, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may establish her in light and peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may call her to happiness in the company of all the saints, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may welcome into his glory those of our family and friends who have departed this life, especially Donald Fritz, Daniel Fritz, Louisa DeBoer, and our extended family members who have gone before us. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may give a place in his kingdom of heaven to all of the faithfully departed. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our shelter and our strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed brothers and sisters. Cleanse them of their sins and grant them the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
And may the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Amen. Look favorably on our offerings, O God, so that your departed servant Irene may be taken up into glory with your Son, in whose great mystery of love we are all united. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
And it is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as one alone he accepted death so that we might all escape from dying. As one man he chose to die so that in your sight we all might live forever. And so in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. Seated. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Ellen our Archbishop, and all the clergy and faithful everywhere. Remember your servant Irene, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
And for the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins which divide us, but on the faith of your church which unites us. And graciously grant your church peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us safely share with one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Mercy.
those receiving communion are asked to come forward and extend your palm. If you are not receiving communion but would like a blessing, merely cross your arms. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof,
but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Scattered and grown, gathered. are one body in this one Lord.
Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our sister Irene may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister. May our farewell express our affection for her. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet her again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow for life. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my God, in whom I trust, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings.
Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. We who were joined with Christ in a death like his will join him in a like resurrection. Let us pray. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister Irene in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Irene in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with all the saints in Jesus Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our sister forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This Mass is ended. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's not true faith in you, make me a channel of your peace. despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. Oh, Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console. To be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving of ourselves that we receive, and in dying that we were born to eternal life.